Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Unfiltered. Pastor, welcome. Well, welcome. You're always welcome.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate you welcoming me.
want to thank you guys for tuning in. You know, Pastor, the last few times that we've been meeting here in Unfiltered, you've been sharing a lot of different things. I've been asking, you know, we talked about the delusions and the reality that people have about delusions, and it went into more recent of the transgender situation. Mm-hmm. We've talked about worship and how sometimes worship is a tool for entertainment. We've talked about the pulpit and how sometimes it can be used for other than teaching God's word. So we've been looking at things within the church that could be concerning. And so as I was thinking about this, I wanted to ask you more of a general question is, what is your, and it's not for much this church, the church overall, as a senior pastor, what is your concern in regards to the church? Or concerns?
What would be a biblical, pastoral concern for a church? I believe that that's pretty, very basic, to be honest with you. I believe that the church is being silenced today in our society, that we are being muzzled. We already spoke on that, but I do believe that. But I also believe that pastors are responsible for the feeding of the sheep, the things that matter. And I think if I were to say my greatest concern at the moment is that many pastors are not teaching the Bible. They're not teaching the Word of God. They are teaching from it, maybe, but they're not teaching it. There's a difference. There's a difference between speaking from the Bible as a platform for you to give your personal opinions and the various things you think may matter, and teaching the whole counsel of God. Calvary Chapel ministry is built on teaching verse by verse, you know, chapter by chapter, book by book. That's what we do. That's what we're supposed to do. And on occasion, we'll do a topical. On occasion, I might speak on something that I think may be relevant at the moment. Maybe I'll do that. I have taught a series, we'll say, on the distinctives of Calvary Chapel. I felt that was necessary for the moment. Or I'll teach a topical series, we'll say, on marriage and the family. I see that as having value. But when that's what you basically get every time you go to church is some pastor's idea of what you need to know right now, I think that that can become distracting and sometimes even lacking in edification. And so what is my concern? Well, my concern is that the church needs to have pastors who are after God's own heart. You know, God had told the nation of Israel that he would give them shepherds according to his heart, that they might feed the people with knowledge and understanding, you know. And I'm not quite sure whether that's true in every church, that the shepherds have a knowledge and understanding of God himself and a knowledge and understanding of God's words, his decrees, ordinances, his laws, or whatever. I think that we have many people in the pulpit today, especially seeing it in the younger pastors who seem to think that the ministry is a fast track for them to become popular. Mm-hmm. And I do see that. Or to go to a church that has a pastor who considers himself above everybody and becomes the actual celebrity in the church, I think that that happens fairly frequently. You can see that on TV all the time. What is my concern? I think as a shepherd, I'm concerned that the sheep are fed. When Jesus was speaking to the Apostle Peter in his restoration, you see it in John 21, when he was speaking to his beloved apostle, this is a man who had failed Christ, right? This is a man who Jesus had to actually, not had to, but whom Jesus actually made a private, personal moment after his resurrection. It's interesting how Luke makes it clear and in other places, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5, for example, it says that Jesus actually appeared to Simon, appeared to Cephas, to Peter. He appeared to him personally. Why? Because the last time Peter had seen Jesus alive was basically when he was denying him and forsaking him. And then later on, it's when Jesus is being walked past him while he's in Caiaphas's courtyard. And the scripture tells us that Jesus turned and looked at him. He stared at him. It's what he did. He didn't just glance. He was walking by and his eyes locked on the Apostle Peter and Peter's eyes locked on Jesus. And then that was the last time he saw him alive. And so Peter had to deal with all of this guilt. And so when Jesus restores him in a full sense to ministry, he just tells him, you need to feed, you need to tend my lambs and my sheep. Do you love me? Then take care of them. See, now that's a minister. That's a pastor. John, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Tend my lambs. You know, Peter, your influence should be used to bring people to a deeper knowledge of me. You've gone through pain. You've experienced it. You know what it means to fail. You have a lot to offer, right? So what we end up with is instead of people who are broken in a pulpit sharing how God heals the brokenhearted, we have people giving psychobabble or political speeches or their particular brand of prophetic understanding or whatever you may want, you know, therapy. That's what you're getting. And instead of a Bible study that's expositional and applicable, a lot of churches today are afraid to offend the sensitive hearers. And pastors, it seems, and churches and church boards are afraid to speak the truth. And I think we have many pulpits today that are built on things that really don't last, John. And so what is my concern is that that I remain faithful to the Word, that I love my sheep enough to tell them the truth. They're really not mine, of course, but the ones entrusted to me, that I love them enough to tell them in a loving way what is true and to try and help them to maneuver through the different pitfalls and minefields that life has, you know. And the only way that happens, John, is to be faithful to the Word. That's why Paul would tell the Ephesians who met with them there in Miletus, he said, I didn't shun to declare unto you the entire counsel of God. I've told you from the A to the Z. I've equipped you as well as I could, and that way I can now entrust you into the hands of God, who will use you in a magnificent way if you remain faithful. And yet within that group, it's very possible there was a man named Demas, who was also from that church, who very well, more than likely, an elder, and very well could have been there when Paul was warning them to remain faithful to God. And so within the confines of the pastoral ministry here in the United States and all, as a senior pastor, if I were speaking to pastors, which God gives me grace to do on occasion, it's always basically the same thing. John, you know this, you've seen this. Stay true to the Word. Give the Word of God. Love your sheep.
And so many places today don't do that. And we see a broken homes, we see broken society, we see a lot of brokenness. And want to encourage a church family that if you're not going to a Bible teaching church, to find a Bible teaching church, hopefully it's ours, we'd love to have
you. If you're in the area.
If you're in the area, yes. But you can also catch us online.
If you'd like.
If you, right, yeah.
I'm not here to you know this, yes. John, but I'm not here to invite people out of other people's churches or anything like that. We know that, but I think I should say that because it can give the appearance that I am. We're just doing this for our fellowship, and should somebody else listen, and if you need a place to go to church and you don't have one, of course we'd welcome you here. But I'm not correcting you. I'm sensitive to that.
No, and I'm always open for correction.
It's
I need a lot
time.
Of it.
I don't have that much time with you. I don't have enough hours, John.
It'll take more than this. But thank you guys for tuning in. Pastor, thank you for sharing your heart. And and to hear the concern from your heart as our senior pastor and shepherding us. Really quickly, somebody asked me today, how does Pastor David shepherd you? And I said, every time he teaches God's word, he's shepherding me, my family, my wife, and passed down through our kids' ministry to my children. And I thought that was an interesting question, given that the position that he is in, and asking me, how do you shepherd me? And I thought about that.
Well, let me share something real quick about that. And I know we have to end right now, John, but you by saying that you provoked me, forgive me. But part of the quote-unquote shepherding is a relationship between the sheep and the shepherd. You know, a sheep that desires attention from the shepherd is going to get it. That's what happens. You know, yes, the shepherd will go out. A shepherd looks for the lost sheep. But there are times when there are, within that flock, there are sheep that just are there, you know, that desire it. And any minister wants to pour into somebody who is a vessel wanting to receive. Any minister wants that. Everyone does. And so with you, how do I shepherd you? You make yourself available. You come in, you sit, you talk to me. You walk into my office and bother me while I'm studying. you obviously want to grow in the things of the Lord. And for me, I am one who wants to pour into you because you're a vessel that wants to know those kinds of things. The way that when I was with my own pastor, Chuck, I would ask him questions. I wanted to hear his heart on things. I did that because I loved him. He was my pastor. And I wanted to learn from him because I could, because he had so much to give. See, so, yeah, how does a shepherd the sheep? The sheep very often have a hunger that provokes that shepherd to want to feed. Mm. It's that simple. But if somebody's just a sheep, we'll say, is there, not looking in any need of any sort, you know, they're not needing attention, but they're just amongst the other. Very often they don't stand out because they're just out there. And so the general thing is you'll feed all of them. Then on an occasion, that sheep may come up, draw near, and that person might start asking personal questions about how can I? And a shepherd very often wants to spend time with people like that so that you can pour into them. They want to know. So I'll share with you, and with you, you take what is being said, and often you'll think that it's the right thing, and prayerfully it is, and I see you put it into practice. So it's a mutual thing, and so the brother who asked you about that probably needs to make himself available too, to the shepherd. Mm-hmm. Develop a relationship if he can.
Right. And that's where we're able to develop a relationship with Christ. That's the beauty of it.
Oh, that's the key.
And the key, which is passed down as a model to shepherds and then even within the church. And Amen. So that's, Jesus is our model. But thank you, Pastor. And I want to thank you guys for tuning in. This Sunday, a couple things, Pastor. We're having our men's conference. Signups and tickets are available for our men's conference June 3rd. Mm-hmm. And you guys can stop by the Gazebo Men after service and purchase your tickets. We have different variety of ticket options. But also we're going to be taking Israel signups or interests.
Interest.
We're going to have an interest
Excellent.
List at the gazebo
Excellent.
That they can go and put their names down for interest. And then later on, we'll be able to have somebody come out and just whet their interest or pique their interest afterwards. And so we look forward to that. Sunday morning, 8:30 and 10:45, invite you guys to come out and join us. And as Pastor, you're taking us through the book of Mark. We're wrapping up the book of Mark.
Eventually.
But a great opportunity to come join us in worship and in God's word, especially in these times where we need to be strengthened by the word of God. Amen. So, Pastor, thank you so much. Thank you guys for tuning in. God bless you, and we'll see you soon.